morning. It is so good to have you all here this morning, those who are in person and those joining us on Facebook Live. I'm certainly glad to be with you as we gather to worship our God. Just a couple of announcements, reminders really. Our second mile giving beneficiary for June is the Bethany Outreach Center. And just put an extra plug, we are also collecting men's clothing, men's and boys' clothing for them. So either a financial donation or clothing donation, they'll take both or either. So whatever you can do, it's much appreciated. We're still inviting you to take registration forms for Vacation Bible School and pass them on to youth that you know who might fit the eligibility requirements, that being 3 years old through fifth grade. And for those who have a fourth through sixth grader, today is the Flying Monkey Inflata Park event. If you have not signed up your children or your grandchildren yet, please see me after church, okay? This morning, we are introducing a new hymn for us. It's not a difficult hymn to learn, but it is new to us, at least as a congregation. You may be familiar with it. Renee was playing it a little bit before service, but it's the hymn of the day, Have Thine Own Way, Lord. And I've asked her to sing it, go over it with us, so that when it comes that time in the worship service, we can sing it as a congregation. Renee, please. We are gathered in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, it is hard to believe that there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding, rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the
Let us pray. O God, you are the tree of life, offering shelter to all the world. Graft us into yourself and nurture our growth, that we may bear your truth and love to those in need.
Amen.
Reading from the book of prophet Jeremiah, 18th chapter. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, "Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so you are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I intend to bring on it. And at another moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will build and plant it. But if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my word, then I will change my mind about the good that I had intended to do to it. Now, therefore, say to the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, look, I am a potter shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you, from your evil way and amend your ways and doing." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, place your words upon my lips and in my heart, that I may proclaim your truth. Today we move to chapter 18 of Jeremiah. In this passage, God invites Jeremiah to enter a potter's shed and there observe the potter working with clay so that Jeremiah may better hear God's words, understand God's way with Israel, and summon God's people to conversion. Have you ever watched a potter work at their wheel? It's a fascinating process. The potter works the clay before it even gets to the wheel, breaking it up and trying to get all the air bubbles out and any imperfections. But he or she continues to work the clay even while it's on the wheel to get it to be smooth, bubble-free, imperfection-free. And sometimes after they're working it into whatever piece of artwork they're trying to make, they squish it all back together because it just wasn't right. And they start all over again. It may take hours for the potter to reshape that lump of clay into something beautiful and something useful. And they may go through this process several times before settling on a final shape. This, for most of us, would probably be unfamiliar and uncomfortable territory. But this is where God leads Jeremiah. Jeremiah must leave his own familiar spaces, step away from the scriptures and the sanctuaries, bypass the committee meetings and professional development seminars, and instead learn about God and God's people by watching an artist at work. We also hear that God did not simply shape us once for all or for all time. To this day, God tells Jeremiah, God's people are like clay that has not yet been fired. As we too go down into the potter's shed, we may learn the difference between clay that has been fired and clay that has not yet been fired. It is this: clay that has been fired dries, shrinks, and hardens into a permanent structure and shape. It may be decorative, but is often functional. And is most often designed for a single purpose. Maybe it's a brick or a tile, a bowl or a plate, a mug, a vase, a pitcher, or a storage jar, or a lamp base. Another characteristic is it's easy to break. Such clay, now called dry ceramic, is often lovely and is often useful. It may be specialized, and it is also rigid and brittle. Clay that has not been fired, on the other hand, is plastic. It's pliable. It may be shaped and reshaped an infinite number of times. It is a material of possibility, moldable, flexible, responsive. Though God shaped humankind, and breathed life into its nostrils, God did not fire the clay from which we were made. There is not one of us who is only a tile, a pitcher, or a lampstand. God is able to shape us and reshape us. And God labors tirelessly at the wheel on our behalf. God assesses our character, perceives our strengths and our weaknesses, builds on our strengths, and when flaws are found in us, works diligently to remedy them. Excuse me. After Jeremiah's visit to the potter's shed, and after God explains to Jeremiah just how God is a potter, and just how God's people are like the clay in God's hands, whom God is able to reform, God switches gears and begins to talk about God's plan for nations and kingdoms. It almost seems to be a new subject, for now God is talking about the house of Israel in particular, but rather about any nation at all. God also sets aside the image of a potter and clay for a moment and revisits imagery from Jeremiah's commission in chapter 1, which we heard last week, plucking up, pulling down, building, and planting. This seeming digression stands as a corrective against a possible misinterpretation of the living parable of the potter and the clay. God's plans for a nation, a people, or a kingdom, God explains, are not fixed, and they are not determined apart from our own choices. God's good plan to build up a people may be thwarted by their own choice to do what is evil. God may plan to pull down a kingdom that has made itself great on the backs of the oppressed. But if that nation turns from its evil, God may decide to alter the plan concerning the destruction that God had planned for it. Just as we, the unfired clay, respond to the potter's touch, to water, and to the wheel, so God responds to us. And so we see that at the heart of this passage is the complex interaction between God the artist and maker and God's people, who are like clay in God's hands, but are also so much more. God will not make us do anything. God will not make us use our gifts or choose the good. Nor will God affect our conversation or direct our lives and our will to a new path and purpose if we do not also choose them. We are neither automatons nor closed circuit systems. The shape of our character and our lives is not fixed. We remain supple. We, as individuals and as communities, excuse me, may be formed through education and the practice of virtue. We may be deformed through abuse and ambition. We are susceptible to influence, suggestion, temptation, and corruption. We are also resilient and capable of astonishing goodness and true conversion. Through it all, even in the company of others and even in relationship with our God, each of us forms our own intentions and exercises our own free will. At the conclusion of this passage, God commands Jeremiah to speak to the people of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, to summon them to conversion. God has planned an end for the kingdom of Judah, but even this future is not fixed. Just as the potter returns to the wheel, so God asks the people to return from the evil path they have chosen and to make their paths and their deeds good. This example from Jeremiah's prophecy should be fairly familiar to us. It should sound very familiar as what Jesus brought to us when he was on the earth. The same call to conversion, the same plea to turn our lives around, to make different choices, choices for good, choices for virtue, choices for high character and integrity, choices for God. In a strange way, we are still in the same situation. We are still being challenged and called to conversion because we are not fired clay. We have not become ceramic. We are supple. We can be further reshaped by God. We have imperfections in us that God desires to remove, and that promise to remove them was confirmed in the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. God won't desert us. We need to place ourselves into the potter's hands to be reworked, purified, reshaped into the image that God has intended for us, into God's great plan for us. So I encourage us to return from our self-centered tendencies and embrace the calling that God has intended for us. And the people of God said, sitting together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us come before the triune God in prayer. Holy God, you plant the seeds of faith in every nation. Enliven your church so that the good news of your grace may root and grow throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creator, even the trees, shrubs, and flowers delight in your goodness. From the depths of the soil to the highest mountain, bring forth new plants and restore growth to the places that are suffering drought. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Judge of nations, we pray for our leaders and those in power. Grant them the ability to regard those under their charge with humility, dedicating their lives in service to others. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We confess, repent, and reject the times when we as a church and as individuals have been silent in the face of racial injustice. Heal the hearts of those affected by racism in our community and worldwide. Lord, in your mercy, grant healing and love to all in need, especially those on our prayer list and those we now name in your presence. Give them tangible signs of your steadfast love. Lord, in your mercy. All who die in you abide in your presence forever. We remember with thanksgiving those who shared your love throughout their lives, especially Blanche M. Jones, Alma Gustafson, and Arthur Peterson. Keep us united with them in your lasting love. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for peace in the world and for the safety of all military personnel, especially those who have congregational ties. Lord, in your mercy.
O God, we lift our prayers to you, trusting in your abiding grace.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer to one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you.
bring before you our gifts of substance and the gift of our lives. We bring our passion and joy and surprise, our visions and dreams. May they refresh and enliven our church and community as the wind of your Spirit did long ago. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, our Lord took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come.
Have mercy on us.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us and keep us in his grace.
Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray.
Amen. The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon us now and forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Christ.
Thanks be to God, and I do hope you all have a great and blessed week.